हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल आर वेल एट होम एंड डूइंग हार्ड वर्क टू अचीव द गोल्स. स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक टू द इकोनॉमिक्स क्लास ऑफ प्लस वन स्टैंडर्ड. यस्टरडे वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद लेसन नंबर 5, इंट्रोडक्शन टू इंडियन इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट. एंड वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन दैट फीचर्स ऑफ इंडियन इकोनॉमी ऑन द ईव ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस. टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक स्टेट ऑफ मेजर इकोनॉमिक सेक्टर्स इन द इंडियन इकोनॉमी at the time of independence. But before that, we will discuss some important key terms like economy, a place where the management of financial matters for a community, business or a family it is held. All the activities related to the production, consumption and trade of goods and services done, that is known as economy. In the economy, our culture it is also there, education it is there, all these things are known as economy. Economic activities, activities of farmers, weavers, laborers, teachers, shopkeepers, doctors, engineers, advocate are economic activities. So the economic activities are those activities which have earning of wealth or money as their prime objective. Non-economic activities, playing football for health, singing for self-entertainment, nursing of a baby by the mother, etc., are all non-economic activities. So non-economic activities are those activities which do not have earning of wealth or money as their main objective, like mother cooks food at home, also that is also non-economic activity. Colonial period, a period in a country's history when it was subject to administration by a colonial power. British Raj, British colonial rule in India, 1858 to 1947, they have ruled out India. That period is known as British colonial rule. Cash crops, coffee, cocoa, tea, sugarcane, cotton and spices, which are the crops grown for the direct sale in the market rather than for self-consumption. Next one is food crops. Rice, wheat, corn, maize, barley, black gram, tomato, brinjal, chili, onion, all these crops are the food crops. These crops are also grown for the sale in market after keeping a part of it for self-consumption. Per capita income. Per capita income is a national income divided by the population size. Per capita income measures the average income earned per person in a given area in a specified year. Per capita income in India is $7,680. Purchasing power parity. Purchasing power parity measures the price of different countries that uses the prices of specific goods to compare the absolute purchasing power of the country's currencies. Gross domestic product converted into international dollars using purchasing power parity rates. International dollars has the same purchasing power over the GDP as a US dollar has in USA. For example, pair of shoes cost ₹2,500 in India. That is a purchasing power parity of rupees for shoes. Tenant, a person who occupies land or property rented from a landlord. That is known as tenants, peasants. A small or poor holders or the agricultural laborers of low social status. That is known as peasants. Now next one is state of agriculture. Small and fragmented land holdings, area of land held by a family, and scattered land holdings were there at that time. Outdated technology, old techniques of production were used, inefficient use of fertilizers, etc. As you can see here, old methods of plowing field, fertilizer, use of fertilizers. Next one is dependence on rainfall. Indian agriculture was heavily dependent on rainfall. No efforts done by Britishers for irrigation facilities. Low level of production and productivity. Output per hectare was extremely low. It produced only 508 lakh tons in 1947 till 1948 of food grains, as against the present level of 2,570 lakh tons in 2013. Only 13 crore hectares of land was under cultivation. Highly irrigated and fertile land went to Pakistan and dismissal of level of agricultural production was due to negligible use of fertilizers, lack of irrigation facilities, use of low level of technology. Productivity of wheat, that is 660 kg per hectare in 1947, as compared to present level of 3117 kg in 2013. Likewise, productivity level of rice was 110 kg in 1947, as compared with the productivity level of 2462 kg in 2013. Next one is stagnation. Agriculture was main activity of the people. At the time of independence, 72% of population was dependent on land for their means of livelihood. It contributed 58.7% of national income. Primary objective of the farmers was to produce for his own family. So Indian farmers mainly focused on the production of food crops, cash crops like cotton for clothes, oil seeds for edible oil, also grown for self-consumption. Agricultural facilities like irrigation, fertilizers, modern technology was very limited. Main factors that were responsible for stagnation in Indian agriculture during the British rule were exploitation of tillers in the hands of zamindars to maximize possible extent, use of old and outdated techniques of production, and less use of fertilizers was there. Forced commercialization of agriculture. Indian farmers were forced to shift to commercial crops like indigo from traditional food crops like rice and wheat. Farmers were given higher prices for producing cash crops. Landlord or tenants relations. During British rule, the owner of land, that is landlord, were not actual tillers. They were just crop sharers and never share the cost of output. They always collect land revenue from farmers. Next one is the actual tillers of the soil were reduced to the status of landless laborers. Farmers were forced to grow commercial crops. Indigo was needed by British textile industries for dyeing, bleaching purpose. Tillers were exploited. They continue to stay in agriculture due to lack of alternative occupation. Industrial sector. India couldn't develop sound industrial base under the British rule. Even the country's world famous handicraft industries declined. The British rule in India led to the decay of world famed traditional Indian handicrafts due to lack of investment opportunities. Growth of modern industries was obstructed. Let's have a look on the Indian industries. Here you can see that the primary objective of the British colonial rule in India was to turn India as a supplier of raw material and as a consumer of finished goods. See the condition of the industries, outdated handicraft industries, basket making, art. So agriculture share, that is only 70 to 75%, and from the manufacturing contribution to the GDP, that is 10%, and service sector, that is 15 to 20%. Next one is development of railway was also there during the British rule. Next one is the British rule deindustrialized the Indian economy. Deindustrialization, behind the deindustrialization policy, there were two objectives of the colonial government. First one is reduce India to the status of a mere exporter of important raw material for the upcoming modern industries in England. Convert India into a market for finished products of those same industries. This led to the decline of indigenous handicraft industries and massive unemployment in India. Import from England was also increased for consumer goods. Causes responsible for decay of Indian handicrafts. First one is discriminatory tariff policy. Import to India was tariff free, while heavy taxes were imposed on the export of Indian handicrafts. So due to heavy taxes on the export of handicrafts made their import difficult in England. Disappearance of princely courts. with the disappearance of Nawabs, Rajas, Princes, Emperors, state patronage to Indian handicrafts came to an end. Competition. Indian handicrafts couldn't face the increasing competition of British machine-made goods, which were cheaper, while that of handmade goods were costlier. So the demand for Britisher goods were more than the Indian goods. Demand for the foreign goods. Some people prefer the British goods, so demand for foreign goods increased in the Indian economy due to cheaper rates. Development of railway. With the development of railways, the marketing of British manufacture across the different regions of the country became easier. So the size of market for the low-cost British goods expanded and that of Indian goods contracted. Next one is very few modern industries. During the second half of 19th century, only those industries were developed which could serve British interest, like cotton, jute, iron, steel, plantation, mining, etc. Some consumer goods industries like cotton, textile, jute, manufacturing, sugar, match industries, etc. were also set up with the help of British capital. But their profit were not further invested, instead used to be remitted to Britain. Lack of capital goods industries. There were hardly any industry which produced machines, tools, which in turn are used for producing consumption goods. Contribution to GDP. 17% contribution to the country's GDP by the industrial sector and provided 1/10 of the employment. That was very less. Role of public sector. Public sector was only confined to railways, power generation, communication, ports, and some other departmental undertakings. Foreign trade. Exporters of primary goods and importers of finished goods. India was well known for its export of goods like fine cotton, silk textiles, iron goods, precious stones, ivory work, and wooden work. But restrictive policies of production, trade, and tariff adopted by the British government adversely affect the structure, composition, and volume of India's foreign trade. Consequently, India became an exporter of primary products such as cotton, jute, indigo, wool, raw silk, etc., and an importer of consumer goods like cotton, silk, woolen clothes, machinery, etc. Monopoly control of India's foreign trade. Monopoly means single seller. More than 50% of India's foreign trade was restricted to Britain. Reasons was that India was a British colony. Opening of Suez Canal in 1869 reduced the transportation cost between India and Britain. Surplus trade. India's foreign trade was the generation of large export surplus. Our exports increased imports, but the surplus couldn't help in economic development of the country. This was the because India had a large deficit in the invisible items of the balance of payment on the current account. The deficit of invisible items was largely financed through the trade surplus. Invisible items means services of shipping, banking, insurance, etc., which cannot be seen or touched. Current account consists of the balance of trade, factor income like rent, interest, wages, and net unilateral transfers that have taken place over a given period of time. Unilateral transfers like foreign aid, it is there, foreign gifts are there. Infrastructure. Railways developed in India in 1853. First railway train was started from Bombay to Thane, a distance of 34 km. By 1900, 40,000 km of railway lines were set up. At the time of independence, total railway lengths were 50,100 km, out of which India obtained 39,300 km and rest went to Pakistan. With the expansion of railways, industrial development in India was there. For example, cotton textile industries in Bombay, jute industry in Calcutta, tea plantation in Assam. It enabled people to move from one place to another. It encouraged commercialization of Indian agriculture and thus affected adversely the self-sufficiency of Indian village economy. India export also expanded with railways, roads. Britishers couldn't develop much roads due to the shortage of funds. National highway was 22 kilometers, State highway was 43 km. Other roads were 335 km. A satisfactory development of water transport, a system of electric telegraph was also introduced and was used to maintain law and order situations. Power. Total generation of power in India since 1950 till 51 was 6.6 billion kilowatt per hour. The major source of power was coal, that is 57.1% contribution. Oil and gas 37.1%, water it is 5.8%. Irrigation. Irrigation facilities were available to 51.5 million area of land, which comes to 17.7% of the net sown area. Health facilities. Health facilities were limited to big towns only. Demographic features. High birth and death rates were there. Birth rates was 45.2%, while that of death rates was 33.3% in 1931 till 1941. Literacy rate. 80% of the country's population was illiterate at the time of independence. Only 7% female were literate at that time. Poor health facilities. Life expectancy was low. It is 32 years only. Infant mortality rate was 218 per thousand. Widespread poverty. Average per capita income was rupees 20 or rupees 30 per annum. As a result, standard of living was very low. Occupational structure. Occupational structure means distribution of workforce among different sectors of the economy. Agriculture sector population dependent was 72% in 1951. Manufacturing sector 10% population was there. In the states like Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, Karnataka, Maharashtra and West Bengal, dependency on workforce on agriculture sector declined. And in other states like Odisha, Rajasthan, Punjab, dependency continuously increased. So students, hope you all have understood the topic of major states of economic sectors in India on the eve of independence. Now it's the time to note down the homework. Explain the state of major economic sectors like agriculture, industry and trade at the time of independence. Second one is, define the following terms with example: discriminatory tariff policy, current account, invisible items. Explain the causes responsible for decay of handicraft industry. And students, please go through the links on the YouTube for more clarity. Thank you for listening.